Thank you, Madam Speaker. Special welcome to the students of Gospel who are here with us this afternoon. Thank you very much. Madam Speaker, I rise to make a ministerial statement. I would especially like to address the issue of domestic violence against women and girls and outline the holistic approach we are taking to tackle this most serious issue. Madam Speaker, we are stitching together a strong coalition to address this crisis once and for all. It is a coalition that so far brings together the various agencies of government and especially the police, along with the representatives of the civil society organizations in Fiji that exist to defend and protect the interests of our Fijian women. Madam Speaker, we can only succeed if we have the assistance and cooperation of our community as a whole, our religious organizations, social, cultural and sporting groups of all kinds, our universities, technical colleges, schools, plus every Fijian of goodwill. We must all support the rights of women and girls to be free from all forms of violence, including sexual and domestic abuse, and the rights of children generally to be reared with love and care that they deserve. Madam Speaker, it is not just about responsibilities of families to make sure that their women and children are safe and are provided with the opportunity to lead healthy and productive lives. We all have a responsibility to do so. So at every level of the Fijian society, we must make this a priority as a people, because our failure to do so is bringing shame on our nation and is damaging the reputation of Fiji and the Fijian people. Madam Speaker, as the Minister for Women and Children, I was deeply gratified to hear our Honourable Prime Minister address this issue so simply and eloquently last week at the World Humanitarian Summit, when he said that there is no justification, no excuse for any man to inflict violence on a woman or abuse her in any way, unquote. It was not just a room in Istanbul that broke into spontaneous applause. I believe most women in Fiji who heard that statement quietly would have said, "Unaka PM," because we finally have a leader, Madam Speaker, prepared to take a stand on our behalf, a moral stand, because that's what it is. Not only a personal opinion of the Prime Ministers, but an article of faith that we all know is reflected in his own life. No justification for violence against women, no excuse. Madam Speaker, the Prime Minister went on to say that men who abuse women are cowards and criminals and should be dealt with using the full force of the law. Zero tolerance for those who abuse women and girls. At this point, Madam Speaker, I'd also like to thank the Police Commissioner for his strong support for the position that our Prime Minister has enunciated. At every turn, the Police Commissioner has indicated that the police will no longer turn a blind eye to such cases. And let's be perfectly honest, that's what has happened before in far too many instances in this country. As the Prime Minister said, Fiji, like many other societies, is patriarchal with a range of institutional and cultural barriers to gender equality. One of those institutional barriers has been the attitude of the Fiji police force. One of those cultural barriers has been the attitude of individual policemen and policewomen, a reluctance to become involved in domestic disputes, too willing to allow traditional means of resolving disputes, too often to get in the way of the secular law of a nation being applied. Madam Speaker, we have had a no-drop policy in place since 1996, a refusal to drop charges of a sort to remove the undue influence that was often exerted on victims to be let to let these instances rest, often by the violent perpetrator himself. That no-drop policy is currently being under review by the inter-agency, the EVO task we talked about in the morning, the Elimination of Violence Against Women Task Force that involves my ministry, the police and the women support groups. Madam Speaker, we intend to make it much stronger because we all know that it hasn't been as effective as it should have been. Madam Speaker, it was the Benimarama government that finally put an end to a basic injustice in the handling of domestic violence cases in Fiji by introducing the Domestic Violence Decree and the Crimes Decree. Most offenders, Madam Speaker, before these laws were put in place, were charged with common assault. Yet this was classified by the law as a reconcilable offence. And if couples could be reconciled, a man who had assaulted a woman would walk free, in many instances, only to offend again. The terms no drop and zero tolerance have to mean just that. And what I mean by that, there should be no undue influence or pressure on victims from their families or the perpetrators to have assault charges dropped or receive traditional compensation, zero tolerance for violence against women and children of any kind, and an unwavering determination on the part of our law enforcement officers in Fiji to bring such cases before the courts. Madam Speaker, the laws are there, and it needs to be enforced. As the Prime Minister stressed, I quote, "We have established unprecedented equality for all Fijians in our constitution, including the right to be free from any form of violence," unquote. And from our supreme laws flow other laws and other amendments that this government has made over the years to enhance the protection of our women, such as amending the old laws that require corroboration in rape cases. Madam Speaker, I'm sure that every woman in Fiji was gratified to hear both the Prime Minister reiterate the zero tolerance policy and the Police Commissioner to stress that this is what will now be rigidly enforced. I say every woman because this is how it should be, for every woman to support this policy, to finally put an end to what the Prime Minister described as a culture of accepting the unacceptable. I'm very gratified that the Fiji Women's Crisis Centre chose to warmly congratulate the Prime Minister for his statement, because whatever our political views in this House and in the wider community, domestic violence must be an issue that is above politics for Fiji to have any hope of tackling its root causes. And we must come together in the national interest to make it a priority to do so. We have seen, Madam Speaker, one or two petty attempts to score cheap political points on this issue in the recent days from people who should know better. And I appeal for this point scoring to be set aside in the interest of all women and children, whoever they are, wherever they come from in Fiji. Madam Speaker, sadly, I also recognize that we have a long way to go, not only in changing the attitudes of men, but also changing community attitudes, including women. As the Prime Minister said in Istanbul, I quote, "We are currently in the throes of a national debate about whether women are in any way to be blamed for provoking their men into acts of violence or inviting rape by wearing provocative clothing," unquote. This, Madam Speaker, is leadership. Our Prime Minister guiding the current national debate by saying very clearly what he believes the national position should be. And many thousands of Fijian women will join me in thanking him for coming down so decisively on our side. No justification for violence against women, no excuse. And I appeal to every Fijian, whether you are a woman or a man, to acknowledge the Prime Minister's stance on this issue and follow his lead and his example. And he also said, I quote, "Any other way of thinking is totally out of kilter within the norms of any society with pretensions of decency," unquote. I happen to believe, as the Prime Minister does, that Fijians are essentially a decent people. But far too many of us are willing to turn a blind eye to violence against women because of cultural reasons or social conditioning. We are certainly more prone as a people than we should be to accept the unacceptable. Because how else are we to account for the shocking levels of domestic violence, shocking levels of rape and child abuse that is currently happening here? Madam Speaker, practicing zero tolerance for violence against women isn't only an issue of justice, fairness, and equal opportunity, but an overriding moral imperative. And this is where I appeal for all religious bodies in Fiji to also take lead, to take a strong moral stance in favor of the rights of women and children, to be free from violence and exploitation of any sort, and especially sexual abuse. It is very disappointing, Madam Speaker, to see some religious leaders laying the blame at the feet of women and girls for some of the violence they are obliged to suffer. We need our ministers, we need our priests, we need our imams to show moral clarity on this issue and help us move the debate in another direction, to uphold the absolute rights of women and children and strongly condemn any behavior that violates those rights or any attitude that condones it. The same message must go out to universities, technical colleges and schools, and indeed wherever Fijians gather. Madam Speaker, violence against women is everyone's responsibility. Every person in every neighborhood, every person in every community has a responsibility to watch out for and speak up against any form of violence, but especially violence against women and children. It is not a question of interfering in someone's business. It is a question of helping us enforce our laws. Madam Speaker, my ministry is working with the police and civil society to educate Fijians on their responsibilities in this area and to provide women with appropriate information on where they can get help. We have a memorandum of understanding with the police force to gather data specifically on reports of domestic violence. and this will give us a much clearer picture of the effectiveness of the police in enforcing the domestic violence decree. It is about ensuring that every case of domestic violence is taken seriously. Evidence is gathered that can lead to successful prosecution. Our courts are able to deal effectively with such cases and issue appropriate domestic violence restraining orders. And the perpetrators of domestic violence are brought to justice. Because only by working effectively together, we can send a clear message, a clear signal to every Fijian that the days of domestic violence being tolerated are finally over. Madam Speaker, it is a sign of how far we have to go that the Fiji Women's Crisis Centre estimates that only 15% of women who experience violence in home will report to it. So we clearly have to make it a lot more easy for them to do so and have their cries heard. To this end, we are establishing a domestic violence helpline, a 24-hour helpline service where people who experience domestic violence or who witness it can talk to trained counsellors. The Honourable Attorney General and Minister for Finance will have more to say about this in the budget later this month. But the preparations to set up this helpline is well underway and we expect to have it operating in the last quarter of 2016. Madam Speaker, this is in addition to the 24-hour child helpline that is already operating and is proving to be of a major benefit to our young people. And we are convinced that the domestic violence helpline will just be important. Madam Speaker, all this is on top of the national gender policy approved by Cabinet in 2014, which is to achieve the elimination of violence against women, encourage more women into positions of leadership and decision making, empower women economically, and give them better access to basic services. The national gender policy requires all arms of government to practice gender equality and build the capacity of women to obtain employment and leadership roles in the workplace. And we encourage the private sector to do the same. So, Madam Speaker, we have put in place means for women to be empowered and give them choices and confidence. But while government can legislate to improve the status of women and give them more opportunities, it is much harder to alter social attitudes. Madam Speaker, the Minister's position to effectively implement the national gender policy has seen to the following. Earlier in the year, members of the Parliament underwent a gender empowerment forum to discuss further how to address domestic violence issues. The forum was instrumental to devise strategies to advance gender equality in Fiji to provide an effective platform for the implementation of our gender policy. We also held policy dialogues for the government permanent secretaries and senior officials to address the importance of developing and protecting the rights of women and children within their own organization. Currently, there is a national gender policy implementation workshop being done in partnership with the Fiji Women's Crisis Center for government focal offices to enable them to share ideas and strategies to implement the national gender policy and, of course, to provide a mechanism to track the progress of work undertaken in the relevant government agencies. The work undertaken in our agencies will include creating committees and coordinating the delivery of awareness materials and trainings apart from the continuous implementation of the key action areas of the national gender policy. Madam Speaker, if I can draw the attention of the House to the zero tolerance violence-free communities. Currently, we have 45 declared zero tolerance violence-free communities across Fiji. There are 26 committed and 16 have been identified, bringing it to a total of 87. Madam Speaker, the zero tolerance violence-free communities are created in partnership with the leaders within the communities, the police force, the religious organizations, and the community itself who go through training phase and agree to commit to their communities being zero tolerance to violence. However, Madam Speaker, strange reports have come to us as well. This is where when you see signboards which say ZTFZ, zero tolerance violence free community zone, that is undertaken the ministry and the police force and the community. But strange reports have also come to us. Even when a community commits to keep it violence-free, we have had incidences of where men have dragged their women right under the zero tolerance board and beaten them up. So that is the attitude. That is the attitude we need to change. And of course, it's going to take a long time. But we all need to be on the same page to see that we progress with this. Madam Speaker, we cannot legislate to force men to change their attitudes. We cannot legislate to force men to change their attitudes because men must take individual responsibility for doing so. So I want to close with a plea to every Fijian man to take a good look at himself and ask the following question. Am I doing everything I can show? Am I doing everything I can to show respect for the women around me? Am I being a real man? Because as the Prime Minister said last week, I quote, real men don't mistreat their women. They treat them with the love and the respect they deserve as wives, partners, mothers, sisters and daughters, because they are the bedrock of our families and our nation, unquote. Madam Speaker, the Deputy General of the United Nations said it was wonderful to hear the head of our government make such a clear declaration in support of the women. And so it was, a speech that was a rallying cry to us, for us to work together to improve the position of every Fijian woman. And as a Minister for Women and Children, Madam Speaker, I commend this to the House and to every Fijian. Thank you.